Hello, Zero K fans. This is Shadow Fury CZ3, and welcome to November 1v1 tournament. Official tournament for November 1v1. And we have an okay tournament turnout this time around. Only about 16 or so players. Not quite as good as a couple months ago, or a few months ago. The last one wasn't great, but this one's a bit better. So we're having some small issues right now. A few of the players have been missing. We will probably sub them in. However, we do have Kenku and AutoWar. That is going to be the game I will be casting. And then, of course, Old Ghost Dark and Mr. Moon. Probably Old Ghost Dark will take that. Orphelius and Parzival. Parzival has not shown up yet. Mr. Moon also has not shown up yet, so depending on who comes into sub. In fact, neither is Old Ghost Dark, so this one's a little bit off. Orphelius is here. Parzival not here at the moment. If Parzival doesn't show up, Orphelius gets by. Reaper Yoliu, also known as Prince Reaper or Princey, not here right now, but probably will be. Bahi Vedanta is here, so we have them. Silent Shadow here, Lancelot is not. Though, once again, possible sub timing. So, unsure about how that's going to work, but anyway. Kenku is also known as... Which one is Kenku? Willk. Yeah, it's Willk. Not really super well known as 1v1 player. AutoWar, I've seen a lot more personally, because they've been talking to me a lot about how to do Lua coding. But I haven't really seen them play too much recently. They're around 1500 elo, but this is a pretty even match. For the rest of them, it's probably going to be Old Ghost Darker or Orphelius. Actually, between these two, no, this is Prince Reaper. I'm not sure who would win this, so if Prince Reaper pops up, I would like to cast this, assuming that it's not already halfway through by the time I'm done with Kenku and AutoWar. And then Silent Shadow is going to win, probably against Lancelot, most likely. And then, of course, Lowry, Clone, and the Sponge are the round two seeds, being the best players currently in this tournament. A little bit surprising that we don't see Kyubey, Golda, or... Actually, Golda hasn't been really active recently. Kyubey also not really active recently, surprisingly enough. Champion from a couple tournaments ago. And Randy also hasn't been seen in a while. A little surprising there. So yeah, that is who we have. That is our lineup for this tournament. Specifically, let's see, any ideas about players? Well, nothing stylistically too interesting to point out that'll likely come up. Orphelius, I do want to see them because partly because they always get a little bit annoyed when I cast their games. It's always a little bit fun. But otherwise, yeah, we have, I mean, Clone, well known for defensive play. Lowry, well known for the love of heavy tanks and hovercrafts. The Sponge, not quite so locked into a style that I can think of offhand. And a lot of the rest of these players, I really don't see a whole lot of in the exhibition match, so I can't really say much about how they'll play. And it looks like, at the moment, yeah, Old Ghost Darker not here, Parzival not here, Prince Reaper not here, Mr. Moon is still unknown who they actually are. But Willk and AutoWar are... Willk, also known as Kenku, and AutoWar are... Sorry, the lobby is downloading Engine 88 for some reason. My apologies. I was rather taken aback by that. Engine 88 hasn't been used in 6 years. I think. Somewhere in that area. Okay. Well, anyway, we're setting up for Kenku versus AutoWar. Like I said, these are both around 1500 LO players, so for those of you watching who... Hey... Hang on a sec. Sorry, if it's not showing up, I don't know why it... Is the stream not showing up? We may be having technical problems. No, we are not having technical problems. We do have a viewer. Detrino is watching. Hello, Detrino. Okay, yeah, early on. Haven't really gotten anywhere yet. And yeah, Kenku and AutoWar, not the most... match people are most enthusiastic about. Sorry, guys, but yeah, you're not super well known. But maybe this tournament will allow you to turn your fortunes around. I mean, you have to go through Lowry, which is going to be a real pain. But who knows? I mean, we'll be watching Kenku versus AutoWar. Where are they? Why are they not here? Anyway, just about to get that started. Okay, Willk and AutoWar, also known as Willk, also known as Kenku, and AutoWar are here, and we are missing a lot of opponents at the moment, so we're probably going to get a few subs in. I'm going to start with Willk and AutoWar, and after that, it'll probably be one of the rest of them, and hopefully these will be done in parallel after Kenku and AutoWar. And this is going to be on Badlands, by the way. So the first match of every round one game is going to be on Badlands. Round two is Isis Delta, for some inexplicable reason. Semifinals is Altair Crossing, bronze is Avalanche, and finals is Kaleo. So a great deal of small maps, with the exception of Isis Delta, are going to be used for this tournament. Should probably go relatively quickly, at least for the first match of every set. After that, it's a little bit less predictable. After the first match, it's going to be loser's pick from all the featured 1v1 maps, and the featured 1v1 maps are, of course, a very wide and varied collection indeed, so what we see will very much depend on what the players prefer. When it comes to the later games, especially in semifinals, we're probably going to see Red Comet and or Comet Catcher at least once, probably at least once per semifinals match. It's a popular map among the higher level players. And the thing is, when you're a higher level player, it's often a good idea to go for larger, more metal heavy maps, because that's an easy way to really show your skill, because you are going to have better experience in the game, you're going to have more of an idea of what to do when you have a lot. When you have plus 40, plus 50 or higher, you know what to do. So it's a lot easier to work from there rather than trying to play small maps, which, I mean, these players can do no problem. It's just that there's a bit more leeway for a weaker player to get in with some cheese. On a larger map, that's just not allowed. The map simply does not allow that to happen, and as a result, the player that can best handle the late game, like 15-20 minute game, they are going to win. However, I'm guessing that at least the first match is going to be... Like Badlands is... That's a game map that could very easily lead to 15-20 minute games, but it'll probably be more like 10 minutes most of the time. And... yeah, at this point, no change to the players available. So we are going to be getting subs in most likely. Looks like Ikins will probably be substituting for Old Ghost Darker, which is unfortunate, because Old Ghost Darker is actually a pretty good player. I really wish they were there. Oh, well, that... I mean, if we get a lot of subs in, this could actually be fairly interesting. Because while I do want to see new players participating in the tournament, I'm glad to see that Lancelot and Parzival signed up. Great to see that. They are up against some pretty tough seeds. I have mentioned double elim as a possible way of getting around this. I really don't think they'd be adding more than one match. If you really think about the way it works, it shouldn't add more than one match in total. But it's something that might happen next year. I'm guessing that we're going to be revising the format next year. But yeah, for the rest of 2014, it's probably going to remain single elim, because it'll be another 2-2 tournament in December near the end. Probably the weekend of the 21st or 20th, I'm guessing. And then, anyway, we are now starting, however. AutoWar and Willk are beginning their match. First match on Badlands, or just about to. Let's see, right now we do have... yeah, we have some sub-candidates. I think we should be able to keep this about the same size. Should be able to sub in. But yeah, my guess, knowing Parzival... I don't know about Lancelot, I've never actually seen them before. Knowing Parzival, they probably think that this is like an hour from now. They'll probably show up an hour from now saying, oh, hey, I'm here, guys. Yeah, you're an hour late, because you don't know time zones. But we'll see. Incidentally, Parzival actually is hosting a 2v2 tournament, a Swiss tournament, much like the 1v1 tournament last month, or earlier this month. They are going to be hosting that this coming December. So it's going to be next week, next weekend, at roughly the same time, and... am I seriously seeing that right? Is it seriously going for spring? Okay, we're having some technical issues, I'm afraid. The engine is trying to load spring 88. Okay, I apologize for this. Also, kind of sorry, I can't seem to see Sackdoth and Floris. I probably should have asked them sooner about coming here. Yeah, Sackdoth and Floris are not here, so it is just me. It will probably be just me for the rest of the tournament. I apologize, I really enjoy... I know you all enjoy hearing Sackdoth and Floris and I talk together about this stuff, and I really enjoy having them on, but they aren't on right now. So if they come on later, I will try to pull them in, try to rope them in into helping me out with this, but at the moment, we don't have that. Yeah, there have been some changes to the way that the infrastructure has been working to allow for quick matching, which I think might be bugged a bit. I'm really not sure. We should be able to start fairly soon. Yeah, I apologize for the delays, those of you watching. But we are beginning. We are now starting, finally. So it is Willk versus AutoWar. And game one on Badlands. And let's switch over to that. Anyway, so Badlands we've seen before. It's a map that's popped up in several of my casts. It's a relatively popular map. It's okay map. It's one that... I'll talk more about the map when the map actually loads up. It tends to take a little while. Yeah, it's a map that is really rather... It's kind of defensive. It's pretty easy to set up defensive lines due to the ridges. And the northwest, southeast are very conducive to building up a force in a very specific location. Like, you want to build up not in southeast and northwest. You really want to focus on that. And there we go. Get everything loaded up. Oh yeah, I probably should have done that a bit better. Anyway... So yeah, northwest, big deal. Southeast, also a big deal. Both of these areas need to be taken. If you want to have any chance of getting anywhere useful in this particular matchup, on this particular map, you need to take one or both of these areas. And that's something that I'm curious to see what players will do. Willk already setting up, they're going for spiders, and also going for far too many solar plants off the bat. Well, AutoWar, on the other hand, has not yet pre-built their build order yet, which is odd. And it looks like, yeah, tourney group D. So it would appear that Prince Reaper and Bakiv Danta Prince Reaper has arrived, or we have a sub. Not sure who is subbing, probably Icons, if I had to guess. Yeah, Reaper, okay, yes, Prince Reaper has shown up. Awesome. There's none in the tournament room, but they have shown up, so we do have another game going on, and yep, okay, so Reaper, also known as Prince Reaper, has shown up, so that match is also going on. Which makes me think that maybe I should be doing that one instead, but whatever. We'll do this. We are here. This is the match we shall do. If AutoWar, there we go, AutoWar setting up. Also going for Spider, very surprising. This is a very Cloaky or Shield-based map. The players might be going for Spider because of the hills and ridges, but these are all bot-pathable. Normal bots can go by this. Spiders aren't really necessary at all. Anyway, see what they go for. A few fleas coming out, normal thing to do. Handful of fleas into a Weaver. This is pretty good setup by Willk right off the bat. AutoWar doing something fairly similar, getting the fleas, hasn't set the rest of their build order yet. Going for fleas into Redback, into Venom, being extremely aggressive, possibly too much so. Although AutoWar is going to be focusing more on metal early on, while Willk evenly splitting between metal and energy. So AutoWar should be able to get ahead pretty quickly within the first couple minutes. But Willk getting some not quite free shots in yet. They can get some free shots on the factory, but they only have about 10 seconds to do so. Not a good idea to do that. Generally, with fleas, you do not want to even try. On the other hand, AutoWar might actually have a chance, but they are wisely avoiding it. They're going in the ridge. They are using the fleas as the map hack that they so Very much are. Fleas are, that's what they do, they are map hack. They're map hack incarnate. Oh, this one's doing a nice job taking advantage of position, but yeah, not, just get out of the way. Or die. Dying is generally unwise. Yeah, Zerg versus Zerg. What the heck, yes, indeed, Spider versus Spider. You do not see this matchup very often, if ever. I can't remember the last time I've ever seen this one. I would definitely say that for this matchup, go for... I mean, the Venoms aren't a bad idea, but really, the Recluse just seems like it'd be a pretty decent choice. The Hermit also seems like a decent choice. The Venom only deals, well, still 600 damage stunner. A couple of Venoms would lock down a Hermit. But then a Recluse could just deal with that. I mean, the Recluse essentially could fill the role of Rocko's, though less accurately. That's the one problem. Definitely less accurately. Excuse me one second. I should apologize in advance. I do have a cold. So if my voice sounds a little bit odd, or if I sniffle, or I blow my nose as I just did, that is the reason why. It is slight illness. Okay, so with AutoWar, they have a few Venoms coming up. Well, on the other hand, Kenku right now has one Venom. They're really focusing heavily on defenses, too much so, really. Willk really needs to focus a lot more on getting their military units. Well, on the other hand, AutoWar in a decent position. They honestly could just attack outright right now. I mean, really, there's just not a whole lot that's set up to defend. The Venoms will be able to march right through, stun this Venom out that Willk has, and then AutoWar will be able to tear apart everything. So this is a little bit slow. I apologize if this game is a little bit slow. I mean, I committed to doing it before it turned out that we had Ripriolu and Bakib Danta going at it. Because it looked like it would be a fairly uneven match, but at any rate, AutoWar is definitely ahead here. AutoWar is very much ahead. Willk, far too much on the defensive, not really building up enough. I mean, they do have a bit more in the way of economy, but only in energy. They have more potential for metal. They can take this pretty easily, but it looks like AutoWar is just going for the southeast. Wants to set that up, has a Weaver also going towards the southeast, probably going to set up a few metal extractors along the way. But yeah, getting that over to the southeast, like I said before at the very start, southeast, northwest, extremely key points to grab. And southeast is a little bit more defensible due to its size, slightly smaller size, easier to build up. You can build defenses around it more easily, and down goes that flea. Venom spots out one of Wilke's fleas, though at this point AutoWar's kind of telegraphed they are trying to go to the southeast, or at least double checking it. And a couple Venoms up for Willk, but really, AutoWar is very far ahead here militarily. If these forces meet up, AutoWar will win. Although it's... okay, about 80% chance AutoWar will win. It'll depend on whether or not these Venoms are close to each other and the other Venoms manage to get stuns off. If these Venoms get stun-locked, then AutoWar will lose their army. Otherwise, Willk will lose their army and AutoWar will have... whoever wins this fight... okay, the fight is actually going... bit of a risky thing to do, but AutoWar is going for it, and AutoWar will lose one of their Venoms right off the bat for basically free. At this point, it's fairly even, and Venoms have been stun-locked very nearly, but it looks like AutoWar will be able to stop the Venoms from stun-locking their forces, and that Redback will get stunned out. And yes, it will! That is Wilke's army not quite gone, though. The Venom was destroyed, and these Redbacks will kill each other. Or no! Willk will actually get slightly ahead, so AutoWar unfortunately did not position their Venoms correctly. Their Venoms got hit by Willk's Venom splash damage, and that did not work out in their favor. Very risky thing to do, and unfortunately did not pay off. Now, they do have more units, but they are still... actually, they're going for Recluses. No, Willk is going for Recluses. Willk going for the better matchup idea. And because they were able to take care of the army, Willk is in a great position. They have the reclaim now, they have the metal. They weren't in a great position before because they were going very slowly about their expansion attempts. I mean, this metal extractor still hasn't been taken yet, but they've been very slow about their expansion attempts. They've been very slow about their military construction, but it worked out. They've managed to get this. They've managed to be able to reclaim this. This entire reclaim field is theirs. This is what? 400 metal worth of reclaim at this stage in the game. That is a couple units right there. I mean, that's two Venoms. That's, well, one and a half, one and a third Recluses. I mean, Spiderbot Factory is a little bit tricky because they have very many expensive units. But still, a couple Venoms isn't bad. Basically, a couple Venoms out of this entire fight. They get their Venoms back, effectively. The ones they lost. And they never lost this... okay, they should repair it. Auto-repairing, but yeah, they never lost the Redback. They basically bought back the Venoms they lost thanks to the Reclaim. So overall, Willk is in a great position. It looked like AutoWar was ahead. They had the military advantage and could have pressed it, but didn't press it early enough. They didn't press it when Willk only had the one Venom. As a result, AutoWar slightly on the back foot, but frankly, they're even. AutoWar, however, because the reclaim is really what's giving Willk the economic advantage right now, they are even. AutoWar is trying to take the northwest, does have the Weaver there, doesn't have a whole lot that's getting in the way, and does have some more units to defend against this. So AutoWar can take the northwest without too much trouble, as Willk is not attempting to cause trouble. Willk have radar coverage, but doesn't appear to be making the connection that there's units going past here, probably stuff in the northeast. Well, at the same time, AutoWar, about the same amount of radar coverage, bit more line of sight, has a nice flea here. Willk has a flea over that did spot the Weavers going across. So Willk should be aware that AutoWar taking the northwest. And it looks like Willk actually is going to try to stop that. Hermit's coming in, Venom's coming in. And once again, AutoWar's Venoms have been stopped, but AutoWar's Redbacks managed to save the day. And this is where the Recluses come in. This is the moment of truth for the Recluses. One of them is going to be a bit risky, though. I don't think one of them is going to work very well. Two of them should work quite effectively, but one of them is going to be a bit slow when it comes to trying to deal with all this. And far too inaccurate. And down goes this Hermit as well. Really a tough thing to put out. Okay, so Hermit's not the best idea, at least not one. A few of them, maybe, but not one. They are cheaper than Venoms, by the way. Considerably cheaper than Redbacks, too. So the numbers on cost equivalency, the Redbacks would probably lose. But in terms of how they'd work, unit by unit, no. No, Redbacks do win. And AutoWar able to win that fight? Still fairly even. The big thing, though, AutoWar does have the northwest, and Willk does not have the southeast. So Willk now behind economically. So AutoWar, I mean, this is all 1.5 each, remember. These spots, all of them are 1.5 each. That's 4.5 extra metal AutoWar has right here. Willk does have a little bit more near their base, does have more of the center, and is pushing out, but still, right now, both players are kind of neck and neck. AutoWar switching over to Gunship Plant, going to Nats. Looks like they're going to try to stun out this entire army. I don't think they're going to go for the commander. I seriously doubt this would be an unwise thing to do if they did. But it looks like Nats... How many Nats set up right now? Two Nats set up. So two Nats will be likely going after this army, try to stun that out. Try to help the Redbacks. One of the Redbacks about to go down. Down goes the other Redback. Will likely go down soon afterwards. As the Recluse numbers increase, it's going to be more difficult for AutoWar to approach, because Recluses, I mean, they're skirmishers, and skirmishers do quite well against the Spider Factory, given that the Spider Factory's strongest units are Riot-class units. Much in the same way that Rocco's work very well against Spider-Bot Factory overall, Recluses should work. But at the same time, they're more expensive than Rocco's, they're far less accurate than Rocco's, they're weaker over than Rocco's, and here come the Nats, moving to stun everything out, trying to stun this entire army. The follow-up, not forthcoming! AutoWar is keeping their forces at home, the Venoms are not moving in, the Redback's not moving in, the Nats will not be able to win on their own, the Nats do not lock down everything. Even with 5 or 6 Nats, Nats have random variants on their shots, just to make sure they don't fully lock down anything. As a result, the Northwest is completely under threat. Willk coming in here. These follow-up forces are still here. AutoWar is not multitasking properly. AutoWar leaving very crucial units idle that would have basically won that fight. When the Nats first came in, they had about a 5-second window. But they didn't use it. That is a huge deal. That is a huge loss. As a result, AutoWar is losing the entire Northwest side of the map. And with that, their economic advantage, Willk going to the Southeast side of the map and will be in a, well, honestly, a better position. AutoWar not really aware of that. AutoWar does not have their radar. No, the radar is not far enough. Willk, while they have lost their radar, at the time they actually had their radar pretty well set up for this purpose. They could have very easily taken... They did know what was going on. They did see the Weaver coming in here. And they can take this out with impunity. They actually have... They've developed a very massive military advantage compared to AutoWar. AutoWar spent a lot of money trying to build this up. The Gunship Factory, that's already like 3 Venoms or a couple Redbacks. And it would appear that they're going for a Venom Redback drop. I have never seen this happen. I have my doubts about its efficacy. Efficacy. I could see maybe if it was dropped on the main base, it might be useful to stem the tide, but even then, it's kind of late for that. As I mentioned on Wednesday, production is deferred military. Destroying the production means that you're destroying the military that'll exist a minute or two from now. But this military exists right now. But yes, that's exactly what's happening. It is in fact going to the main base, and it will be able to take out most of the main base, or at least do some damage. The two redbacks going down pretty quick. This factory, the Lotus here, dealing most of the damage. That Lotus is down, the other Lotus is down. The Recluse doing a great job defending, as is Willk's Commander. The Willk's Commander does go down, helping AutoWar in terms of economic parity. But even then, this is stunned, but like I said, deferred military. This military exists right now, is much larger. We will get a tear apart the factory, and with the military over here and really out of position and not doing much and ultimately dying, AutoWar's lost this game. We're going to game 2. AutoWar gets map pick. It's a loser's pick. It's first is always Badlands, and after that is loser's pick. Game 2 is AutoWar's pick for map because they have lost. And really, that just came down. I mean, that gunship plant kind of mistimed. And those gnats could have done a great job if the follow-up forces were in tow. If they'd popped in right as the gnats came in. And yes, redbacks only wouldn't have been a bad idea. Like, if 2 or 3 of those venoms were redbacks instead, would have torn the base apart very easily. But they didn't. So that is game 1. Willk is up 1-0 to AutoWar. This is best of 3. And we are moving on to game 2, which will be on a map of AutoWar's choice. Now, AutoWar was asking about cheese, so I'm guessing they're going to go for a smaller map, possibly Desert Cliffs, or maybe... I don't think they're going to go for Avalanche, that's not likely. What else would it be? Let's see, it is... Yeah, if AutoWar had... I mean, that base race would have gone a lot better with the... Oh yeah, Brawlers! Yes, Brawlers are definitely a good one, because... Well, I mean, like I said before, Spiders do not do great on range. That's why Rocco's win. That's why Recluses can do so well. They don't do well in range. They have really good anti-air, but it's 400 metal. It's hugely expensive. Excuse me. So Brawlers would have done decently well. But overall, yeah. The Gnats were a risky choice. They could have worked, but there was a 5-second window. A 5-second window where multitasking would have had to be perfect. And multitasking wasn't perfect. I mean, we're dealing with 1500 LO players. Multitasking is probably going to be their weak point. It's difficult to do well. Something that requires a lot of practice in order to get right. And that's what we saw. Those units were hanging out, doing effectively nothing. And as a result, we ended up with a situation where they basically had nothing to work from. I mean, AutoWar had their units right there. They had all the units that Willk had set up. Those were all stunned. That army could have been wiped out. The Northwest could have been saved, and then from that economic advantage, the gunship plant would have been a more viable option. And we are going to Quicksilver. AutoWar is choosing Quicksilver. An interesting choice. I'm guessing AutoWar is going to probably go... Oof. Light vehicles or jump bots? I kind of think AutoWar is going to go for jump bots. I have a feeling that's going to be the case. But we'll see. So AutoWar is picking a map which can kind of work for cheese. It is a bit of a low econ map, and I've seen cheese work decently well on it. But it'll be interesting. If they go for air cheese, I can kind of see that. I mean, I wouldn't recommend going for cheese if you're one game down. That's something you do if you're one game up. Or on the very first game to get a free game in, so you're only one game up from the start. Having it just like this right now, I really don't agree with... Well, at least if it's trying for cheese. They might not go... Oh, whoops, I'm building the game. So... We are now getting on to game 2, and I should update this soon. Yeah, game 2 is going to be on Quicksilver. A low econ map, one with a focus more on territories. One of the best maps, I think, for for demonstrating the importance of territory control in 0K. Rather than, say... Okay, I don't know if it's saving or not. It demonstrates the importance of territory control. It's a bit less on the economy side. I would definitely go with... Okay, so we have the map right here. I keep forgetting to do that. So, Willk up by one. Yeah, this map, 1.5 metal across. As you can see, there's a lot of open space, a lot of choke points, a lot of places you can set up soft territory control around here and around here. And you can pretty quickly take this area over to the northwest, to the southeast. And even the back here, there's a lot of open space that you can control to take it. And this is all very flat. I mean, this is an extremely flat map. It's also very shiny. It's kind of plastic, honestly. I mean, maybe it's supposed to look wet? I don't know, it's always look kind of plastic to me. But I digress. Artistic comments aside, this map, I'm not sure what Ottawa's going to go for. Jump bots are common, light vehicles are common, air start is uncommon, but Willk is going for heavy tanks. Okay. That's a little bit difficult to pull off. I mean, plus 1.5 on all this stuff. There's, well, 6 metal right inside your base. Another 6 or so right outside of it. So you get to plus 12 on metal spots alone, let alone overdriving your commander. But you still need about plus 30 or so to make heavy tanks work really well. And for some reason, Volkay's gone over to the northeast. Okay, that was a little bizarre. Yes, heavy tanks can work. Once you get to plus 30, building Reapers is no problem. Anything below plus 30 metal, it becomes difficult to build anything other than Panthers and Kodachis. Because Kodachi is... Kodachi's your standard rating force. Panthers are, of course, the bread and butter, as anyone who's played heavy tanks at all or played against heavy tanks at all would know. It's definitely what Willk will be going for. I'm assuming they know their heavy tanks well enough to know they want to build Panthers, and lots of them. AutoWar going for shield bots. A solid choice, though unusual on this particular map, but definitely a solid overall choice. Shield bot factory. See what they do with that. They have going with convict start. No real surprises, a decently large map, and there's a lot of reclaim to work from. I mean, right in your main base alone, you have, 5,000 energy, so it's energy reclaim, but still, there's not a whole lot of reason to build power plants. You can just reclaim all this stuff. Build metal, and then reclaim the trees. That's a huge amount of reclaim, actually. 3,000 energy worth of reclaim, my goodness. I mean, that is, for reference, that's basically 5 minutes worth of 5 solar collectors at the cost of 2 constructors. Like, every constructor effectively is 2.5 solar collectors. Or, let's see, wind generator 0.5. Yeah, so about 4 or 5 wind generators, 1 constructor on reclaim for at least 6 minutes. That's huge. Now, Willk, on the other hand, also going for welders. Actually, not only on the other hand, it's the exact same strategy, going for early constructor. And Ottawa going for yet another constructor. They have an outlaw. What? You're serious. It's an outlaw. This is minute one. Okay, whatever. I'm not going to criticize too much. Okay, I'm going to criticize too much because, frankly, you can't criticize too much. This is very surprising. Apparently, some concern about ticks or roaches or scuttles, maybe, about cloaked units overall. I mean, Gremlin, I can see, yeah. So Outlaw being used, I guess, as a buffer for that. Well, Kodachi comes in here. Willk starting out pretty strong with his Kodachi. Yeah, that Q, what the heck? Outlaw and Convict. The Welder makes sense. Heavy tanks really rely on their early constructors, especially on the map like this, where economy is hard to come by. And Willk is... They are building a lot of metal, but not reclaiming very much. There's so much reclaim that could happen here. This Kodachi is getting slowed, which is working out nicely for it, but even then, it doesn't matter. Just sets everything on fire. The Lotuses, on the other hand, will be able to get rid of it. It's going to burn down one of the Lotuses, maybe, but it is going to get killed, and that's... Oh, it does not get killed. Willk needs to run this away. That is exactly what they're doing. Perfect. Very well done. Gets out of there. Gets alive. Gets the damage done. Gets rid of a metal extractor and slows down AutoWar a bit. And I think we'll get rid of the... No, we'll get rid of the Lotus. The Lotus will stop burning before it dies. Still, these outlaws are not the right option. The right option is bandits. Or, I mean, if they're going to go outlaw, build thugs. Just go thug law. I mean, early thug law is a little bit unusual, but thug law. Yeah, no wind generator. Yeah, for Steelbot Factory. Weird. Outlaw convict is not something I have ever seen in 1v1. Ever. You'd have bandit support, you'd have thug support, you'd have felon support. But pure convict outlaw? Maybe that's a team game strategy, like a large team strategy. I have never seen it in 1v1. In none of the games I've cast, none of the games I've played. It does not come up. And yeah, there are some wind gens being built. I am very surprised AutoWar has not reclaimed. Because there's still 3,000 energy here. Oh, the tank player's good. Yeah, all welders. Yeah, louder you'd know. You would definitely know, being our resident tank player master. This is probably too many welders. There's three so far, and more Kodachis and Panthers should be built by now. Like, there should be two of each Kodachis and Panthers. A couple welders aren't bad, but yeah, at least a couple Kodachis and Panthers. Willk has the resources for it, and really needs to do a bit of raiding. These outlaws are starting to become a bit scary. I mean, it's... AutoWar is starting to justify their strategy. Going for these outlaws. They're certainly making the convicts difficult to harass, and Panthers would do a pretty good job. Panthers, I want to say have area of effect, but I kind of doubt it. But they probably do. If Panthers have area of effect, that's going to help a ton. Because area effect gets through shields like nobody's business. And of course, Kodachi here has auto-repaired. Can get some shots in. It's going to be tough to get through the outlaws, though. Going to get a couple shots in to deal the damage it can, and does set that outlaw... Sorry, just sets the convict on fire. Should be able to get rid of the radar, too. Very cleanly done. And other than that, Will K, though, taking the territory... Ooh, trying to take the territory over in the northwest. AutoWar very quickly grabbing it, though. AutoWar still doesn't have the strongest grasp on the territory. The Kodachi has an easy time... Will have a very easy time getting through this. Just get rid of all of these one by one. These melee extractors will not last long. They won't last long enough to pay for themselves. I've mentioned many times, do not be afraid of building metal extractors where your opponent might kill them if they'll last at least a minute. These have lasted at most 30 seconds. They have not paid for themselves. Oh, Panthers get AoE on death? That's what I thought. Okay, so, or that's not what I thought. I thought they got AoE in regular attacks. They do not. They have direct damage attacks. It's still a fair amount of damage being dealt to these shields. I mean, the shields have... strength of 900, so that is a couple Panther shots. Two Panther shots, they're down, and the Kodachis fire through them. And more Panthers coming in, and Reaper... Oh, actually, that's not a bad timing for Reaper. It's a little bit tricky, but it is less than a minute. Will K will be able to build a Reaper in a decent amount of time. Reapers do cost 850? Yeah, with 20 metal, that would take about 40 seconds. That would take under a minute, though. So Reaper coming in already for Will K. A little bit risky, this Panther going down for nothing thanks to the Faraday. Another turret you do not see very much in high level play, but probably could do a little bit more for them than realize. I mean, could use a little bit more love. I can see Faraday being used from time to time. It's a tricky one though, because once your opponent knows it's there, they can just send fodder over, unless they're playing heavy tanks, but they can just send fodder over, or they can just avoid that area entirely. I mean, Faradays are a bit of a scary tool. They do just have kind of short range. But they are EMP. That can be tricky to work with. Yeah. Okay, Lowry's pointing out Panthers are bad at against shield bots. Then Panthers are bad at against shield bots. Like I said, Lowry would know. Let's double check their radar right now. So, AutoWar right now, total knowledge of what Will K is up to in terms of radar dots. Will K, on the other hand, doesn't know much. Has the middle of the map and nothing else. They really have no idea what AutoWar is up to. They have some idea of AutoWar's attacking right now, and the Kodachis are coming in here, getting decent damage dealt, but yeah, the Faraday and the Outlaws together, these Outlaws are starting to work out, but oh, nice Panther AoE! Perfect there, though, a little bit too short-lived. Good positioning on the Panther, though. But yeah, that's not, it's not a tick. It isn't a tick. Very important to keep that in mind. Panthers, they deal AoE damage, but it lasts like 2 or 3 seconds. It doesn't last 20. 20 seconds is what you're thinking of. And some rebuilds here. Will K setting up the Northwest. They're ahead economically. And AutoWar actually hasn't gone past the plus 20 hump. They have nothing built to make anything work better. They are reclaiming, which is great to see. But yeah, they aren't building any caretakers at all. They have no caretaker set up. They have no builder set up. They are accessing a plus 20 metal. It's a big hump for new players to get through, is that you want to make sure that when you're up to plus 20 metal, you have a caretaker. You need to have that in order to make sure that you're not accessing. Or an additional factory, but this is very rarely is there a reason to build an additional factory at plus 20. Plus 30, yeah, maybe. Plus 40, definitely. Plus 20, no. Plus 20 is a bit too early. And interesting pillager usage from Wilke. Artillery has become a lot more popular in the last couple months. I'm not surprised this is being used. And especially when you're dealing with shields and you consider the fact that shields don't need a whole lot of accuracy to destroy. I mean, the Faraday is going to be hard to kill, but the shields themselves, hitting the shield, any part of the shield, damages the whole shield. So AoE is really not necessary. Sorry. With AoE, it's not necessary to hit. With inaccurate attacks, accuracy isn't necessary. You can just hit any part of the shield, it destroys the whole thing. Or damages the whole thing. Now, Pillager does have AoE, so that helps a lot. The Reaper does not, however. The Reaper's actually fairly easy to dodge, though. In a clump like this, not so much. One outlaw does go down, but the Reapers are getting surrounded. They should be able to last a decent amount of time. They should be able to get rid of all the outlaws, actually, in that time. The Pillager, on the other hand, not so lucky. Goes down very rapidly. Gets marched into a stinger and gets killed. Rather mooting the point of that particular Pillager. But more Pillagers are coming in. Pillager could actually Tremor. Tremor is going to be canceled, actually. That got canceled. Willik not going for that. They are going for Banishers, however. Not at all surprising. AoE is definitely good, like I said before, good to have. And Racketeer is coming in, which... decent counter, but this is not going to be going anywhere fast. This is heading towards a stalemate situation. Although, that being said, Willik is keeping the Reapers alive. And once you get 5 or 6 Reapers, you effectively have a Strider class unit. The Racketeers are helping against this, but at the same time... they target fodder like Panthers and Kodachis, they are going to be wasting their shots. Which is actually what we're seeing. The Reapers are not getting hit on account of radar wobble. All that can be seen here, Willik doesn't actually know where they are. So you can see the radar dots do not match the unit's position at all, so the Racketeers are missing. While the Kodachis and Pillagers are doing a decent job. The Kodachis, Panthers, they're taking the hits, but that's fine. That's exactly what's desired, that's what you need. And where's that? Okay, there's that Pillager. And it's hitting the right target too, because that's what it wants to hit the shield ball. The Pillager needs to hit the shield ball. If it hits the shield ball, it is doing its job right. If it's anything else, it's doing an okay job. But hitting the shield ball, hitting that convict ball, that's exactly where the Pillager will shine. And down goes one Racketeer. Another Racketeer going to go down soon after. This Kodachi is the only part that hasn't been disarmed, however. But still, that Racketeer being forced back as a result. And the Reaper's getting some free shots in while the Racketeers are on reload. Not able to hit very effectively, because like I said, Reapers aren't super accurate. They can be dodged fairly effectively. Especially if your opponent knows when to run away. Like, I think Reapers have a 4-second reload time. Yes, they do. So if you count up the reload time and you move your unit right as the Reaper would fire, it's easy to dodge their shots. I mean, it requires a lot of multitasking and a decent APM. But it's definitely doable. And it's pretty nice to do, and it's a great feeling when you actually pull it off. And it's very handy as well, especially if you're chasing down the Reapers with Warriors or something like that. Because Warriors, they're just fast enough to dodge it, maybe a little bit faster than the absolutely necessary minimum speed. And they do a decent amount of damage against Reapers. Like, I have beaten Reapers with Warriors just by a good micro on that. It's a very, very good feeling to have. And this is where the splash damage comes in, that Banisher... doing a decent job. Well, the Kodachi coming for follow-up and the Reaper as nice fire support, though. That Banisher will... I don't think it'll go down. The Pillager will go down. The Panther coming in for extra fire support. That Pillager probably won't survive, and it actually does. How about that? Pillager is actually going to stay alive. That is the end of AutoWar's army, and at this point, AutoWar, they have basically nothing left. They have Racketeers. They're going for Felons. They're not Felons. I wish I could say they're going for Felons. They're going for Rogues, not Felons. They're going for Felons. That would have been a slightly better follow-up, though they ran out of most of their shields. And this is where we have half Strider class worth of Reaper count, though one of the Reaper... this Reaper needs to retreat. This Reaper must get out of there. Too late now. Still, three Reapers are coming in. Two full health Reapers, one half health Reaper. This area up here is getting knocked down, but the Racketeers are doing their job. This is where an air switch would be very useful. Will K should pull in an air switch right now. Pull in an air switch, pull out some napalm bombers. Actually, I think so. These raptors have 950 health. Okay, napalm bombers is a little bit risky. That might not work. Ravens would. Phoenixes might. But these fractures are starting to become rather difficult to deal with. That or get more fodder units. Just go for Cloaky Switch. Cloaky Switch would also work because it is, well, it's an easy kill. I mean, they just rush in, kill the racketeers. The racketeers have a bunch of false targets to hit. Then the Reapers get to shoot their shots because they are not getting hit by the racketeers. They aren't being stopped. But I don't think it's going to happen. I seriously doubt that Wilke is going to think I should go for Cloaky Switch. It's a bit of a counterintuitive thing to do because they are a weaker factory, and you usually think, I want my factory switch to be air. But in this case, Phoenixes might work, Ravens might work. Glaives would do wonders. Yeah, and Clone pointing out that preparing the Reapers is extremely important at what the welders should be doing, and that's what the welders are going off to do. So Will K a bit on the ball there. To point out that that was a spectator to spectator chat. I'm only seeing it because I'm a spectator in this game. That was not to the players. Will K on the ball, but what to do? But these rogues. These rogues are starting to really pile up. 20 rogues, they're working out okay. And bandits coming in on top of that. Yeah. Glaives. Glaives would be the thing to go for. There's no denying that. Kodachi's would also be a decent idea, but they would probably go too slowly. The rogues should be able to kill them. Yeah, if there were, and there are Kodachis coming in there, but Glaives would be far more cost effective. And the first Kodachi is coming in here. It's gonna deal a bit of damage, but it's gonna have a hard time getting out of there alive. As in an impossible time, as in it needs to retreat right now before it dies. Why is it going to its death? That was not the best use of a Kodachi. They need to live. However, that did give the Reaper some breathing room for at least a couple seconds. Not enough though, it is not taking advantage of it. Ottawa were able to basically take the game back with those racketeers. They were not being called OP racketeers for nothing. These things are scary. And Will K underestimated them. Did not throw enough fodder in their path to make their shots completely worthless. Did not rely enough on radar in order to make their shots miss half the time. He's not repairing these units despite the fact that the welders are in position to do so. This Reaper going after his death. Will K is not multitasking properly. This Reaper is being moved to his death. Everything's on fight order. But not being, Will K is not paying attention. Where is Will K paying attention to anyway? What? Will K's folks entirely in the Northwest. Why are there folks in the Northwest is beyond me, but they have not paid any attention to this battle over here, or very little attention. Not repairing enough, and for some reason reclaiming. Yeah. If you're playing heavy tanks, it's because you repair. When you're playing Reapers, you repair. If you do not repair, you lose. That's how you play heavy tanks. You have to repair your units. You have to repair your Reapers especially. But your units in general, Reapers do not want to have units die. I mean, I pointed on the analysis cast on Wednesday, you generally don't want units to die. Heavy tanks, triply so. Every dead heavy tank unit is about 5 dead units from any other factory. Especially when you get up to the Reaper class units where it's 850 metal per unit. I mean, these things are half striders. Well, not quite half striders, like thirds or quarters of striders. But yeah, they're quarter striders. Treat them as such. They are precious. Unfortunately, we see a lot of Reapers have been just sacrificed for basically nothing. Could have very easily been saved. That was actually a banisher over there. Still an important thing to keep alive. At this point, Will K is paying some attention to this battle, but it's not going well. Like I said, not the right unit mix. Switching over to a more fodder-heavy factory like Cloaky, that would be the way to go. Or, like I said, maybe air factory for napalm bombs, but I would just go for the glaives. Like, 30 or 40 glaives rushing into this mass of rogues, ripping them to shreds. That would turn this game around and give Will K some breathing room. Now, at this point, Will K is managing to push through, has split up some of the forces in corner to feed them as well, thanks to this Kodachi somewhat, mostly because the Kodachi is tanking all the racketeer shots, giving the Reapers enough room to deal with the Stinger, deal with the Faraday, deal with everything, really. Break this line. But that wasn't the line. The rogues were the line. The racketeers were the line. That defensive turret position was just a defensive turret position. It was a small firebase. It wasn't really anything beyond that. Like, this is the line. This is the line that they have to deal with. This moving line right here. That's what AutoWar has. That's AutoWar's pressure. As right now, they're actually dead even on economy by cost. AutoWar's got a lot of smaller units, and like I said, would be very vulnerable to a mass glaive rush. But Willk does not have that. And the Kodachis they've been throwing out have been literally just thrown out, like garbage. Which they aren't. And another Reaper being just thrown to its death. If Willk wants to know why this game is a loss for them, which it is very rapidly turning into, I mean, it's been a loss for the last 5 minutes. They want to know why it was a loss. It's because they were not careful enough with their heavy tanks. Good banish shot though there. That was a good positioning. The clumping here, I mean, AutoWar is going on fight order as well, and the fight order is not a line move fight order, it's a point fight order. So these rogues on their way to their target, on the way to the target position, they are not actually moving in any useful way. They're clumped up. Now rogues can fire above each other, they do fire in an arc, so clumping isn't as big of a deal from a blocking each other's fire perspective, but it is from a splash damage perspective. However, it does not matter. Willk throws in the towel and AutoWar evens out the series. We are on to game 3. Willk getting the map choice and very surprising loss there because Willk had a massive advantage at the start. It really wasn't until basically the first few racketeers came in and Willk didn't respond properly. He didn't build enough fodder, didn't try to smash through this. I mean, they paid too much attention to the north. The northwest was way too much their focus. And they didn't go for the attacks when they had the chance. I mean, there was a lot of... They had a decent amount of time. They could have just actually plowed through, pretty much. The racketeers were a threat, but the one or two racketeers wouldn't have been a big deal. And like I said, not switching to fodder, bit of a problem. But yeah, that was... And yeah, Kodachi spam would have also dealt with that. I still think glaive spam would have been the best option, but without switching factories, Kodachi spam would have done the trick. Anyway, we are going to be moving on to game 3 once Willk chooses the map. I suspect, let's see, any change, and it looks like we have Bakiv Danta beat Prince Reaper 2-0. So it turns out that I was in fact casting the most even matchup so far. Very likely to be the most even matchup unless something has changed in the brackets. And Eikens, okay, Flaccid moving in for Lancelot, Eikens moving in for Parzival, Mr. Moon has not been found or has been found and is playing one of the two, I do not know which, but we do have these games going on as well. We are going to be... Just point out these players actually both on... Okay, Flaccid versus Silent Shadow is starting right now. I won't be switching over to that, but just worth pointing out. Because we're moving to game 3 of Willk and AutoWar. And Orphelius and Eikens going against each other. Apparently they're both in GBC. Thank you, Anakid, for that bit of trivia. Oh, Wanderlust. Okay, for some reason I got Wanderlust and Quicksilver confused. So we have Wanderlust, that is the next map. We'll be getting that started in just a couple seconds because no reason to dawdle. And Wanderlust, I mentioned before, is one of my favorite maps. It is a really cool map. It's a map that I'd say does have a good set of options to it. I don't think we're going to see heavy tanks again, though. Lowry's not playing. I've seen Lowry go heavy tanks in this map a couple times. It's actually pretty interesting. It does work fairly well, but it'll probably be Cloaky. And we'll see, though. Neither of these players have gone from the expected factories. I mean, shield bot on Quicksilver, wouldn't see that coming. A jump bot light vehicle. Heavy tank makes sense. It's a bit out of the way, but it's like light vehicles. I don't know. Shield bots, I've seen, I think, once or twice. Cloaky is another common option, but shield bot's a solid option. I mean, if you go for shield bot, you're going for consistency. You're going for something that's solid, that's strong. There's nothing wrong with it. There's absolutely no shame in it. I mean, to say there is would be just ignorant of what shield bot can do. It's a solid factory on any map that's not too big. And Quicksilver's not too big. However, on this map, it would work. I mean, shield bot's definitely a solid choice in this map. Cloaky, however, is Willk's choice, though someone's going for the expected factory. About time. Although, once again, Willk going for a lot of energy first off. Just general tip I mentioned before, you want to go 2 metal, possibly 3 metal, then go for power. Now, you want to get at least plus 5 metal before you start going for energy. You can afford a bit of energy stall in the beginning of the game. Bit of an advanced tactic, but you can afford it. And it'll generally help out when it comes to building things just a tiny bit faster. But that tiny bit faster in the early game is huge. Winning and losing when you're at the high level, that's the difference between winning and losing. is whether or not you get that slight advantage early on. A lot of little things like that. Willk, a little bit too focused on setting up their energy early on. But at this point, I guess AutoWar, not the biggest deal. Just an important thing to point out. And AutoWar, I don't know if AutoWar's... I know AutoWar's aware of the early opening factory stuff. I just am surprised they haven't used it very much. The pre-game queue. Yeah, AutoWar, we will see once they've decided what they're doing, where they're going, how they're planning on setting this up. I don't know. I'm really curious what they have in mind. Knowing them so far, they probably will go for Cloaky, but I can't see them doing anything too unusual right now. We'll see, though. And just as other tournament news, Mr. Moon, Old Ghost Dogger, and apparently the Sponge has left. What? I thought the Sponge was here. So Mr. Moon and Old Ghost Dogger was one match on its own. Kind of waiting on that. Unfortunately, not as good as the August tournament. The August tournament was the best organized it could have possibly been. This isn't that. AutoWar going for Gunship. Well, of course. Of course they are. They're going for something weird. Willk, on the other hand, going for Cloaky Bot Factory. Totally normal. Five glaives to start. Very aggressive start. Oh, never mind. Sorry. Two and worker. That makes more sense. Well, three and worker. That's a much more typical, safe, going for the mid to the game start. Like, that is a mid to late game focus start right there. But Nats? How many Nats? I mean, I think AutoWar is going for a Nat lockdown. But as I mentioned before, Nat lockdown isn't something that works reliably. The random chance on the shots, you could do it. I mean, 20 Nats will probably do the trick. But it's a tough strategy to make work, and are we seeing it? No, we aren't. No, AutoWar has actually stopped building Nats entirely. They have half a dozen. Yeah, Nat lockdown is not likely to happen. I mean, they'll have... If they have three in the factory and three on the commander, I could see that working out, but they do there is a conjurer. No, all six on the factory. Kind of going about. Yeah, this is Nat lockdown, but a little tricky to make work. Nat lockdown, he's not getting the glaive, not getting the commander. The commander is jumping away, and more glaive support is going to stop this. This Nat lockdown will fail. The glaive is doing a decent job, but they're spread out enough that it's not really going to work getting rid of yet another Nat, and this is too few Nats to make that work, and there's no follow-up. There was no transport to try to comnap. There was no rapier to try to just, as everything's kind of locked down and slowed, to deal with the remaining glaives to get rid of the fire support. Nothing, no follow-up whatsoever. AutoWar just went for half a dozen Nats and nothing. I know they were wanting to know if they could cheese, and yeah, it's perfectly legal to cheese, but if you're gonna do it, you know, do it right. Like, actually commit. Get a strategy that works for cheese, because if you're gonna do cheese, there's a lot that goes into it. A lot of little niggly details. Yeah. And yeah, like Anakin said, cheese is perfectly fine. Cheese is fine. You can do it. There's no reason why you can't. I mean, you may do it. Whether or not you can do it comes down to how much you've practiced it. But it's perfectly legal. It's just apparently not something that AutoWar has done a whole lot of practice on, a whole lot of working out the build orders for. Yeah, at this point, I mean, they're doing what they can, but really, AutoWar's commander, under some fire, not going to go down. No problems there. It's just that was... Yeah. Cheese is permitted. May not be possible, but it is permitted. And Willk going for Gremlins, as they naturally would. I mean, why wouldn't you? You've seen your opponent has gone for air. A few Gremlins will be built up, and that'll just scare out these Rapiers. Now, a Brawler coming in from here would actually do a decent job, but I don't think it's going to happen. I think we're going to see more and more Rapiers. And AutoWar at this point, kind of getting desperate. I mean, they're +8 to +14 from Willk. They have some reclaim to work with, but not much. And so far, only a couple Rapiers. They're trying to scout around. And at this point, we do have two Gremlins on the field. Well, one in production, one on the field. The Rapier should be able to get rid of the Gremlin, but the Glaives can beat Rapiers. Like, Gremlins are not necessary. In fact, compared to firepower, compared to damage per second, they're actually not even that useful compared to glaives for cost. But honestly, it doesn't matter. There are enough of them. The rapier goes down, and AutoWar is probably going to lose this game as well. They do not have the advantage of surprise. They don't have the advantage of any particular 1-2 punch they can throw out there, like a Calm Nap or Nat. Like, Nat Lockdown into Brawler Knockdown, while extremely risky and probably not possible, really, on a map this size. Honestly, I don't know why. Wanderlust is really small for this. I could see this working on Ravaged. I could see this working on maybe Trojan Hills. It'd be a bit risky to pull off. What else could I see this working on? I could see this working on pretty much any map where you can defend pretty easily from one position. Ravage is the only one that really comes to mind. Yeah, it's Nat Banshees is a good idea too. Actually, Nat Banshees is a better idea because Banshees are cheaper. 220 metal compared to 30 metal or 300 metal. Yeah, much better idea. Brawlers is risky. A bunch of gnats and one brawler would be really tricky. And yeah, Skyosy's right. They do actually two-shot glaives. Glaives are 200 health and rapiers deal 190 damage. It's close, but they do two-shot them. It's important to point out, rapiers do not one-shot glaives. It would have been useful fire support, but in the original rush. But yeah, that's not going to happen. This is going to be a quick game three, and Willk will be moving on to fight Lowry. Because AutoWar's got nothing going. I mean, AutoWar's, they're reclaiming the gunship plant. They might try to do something tricky, but they're accessing at this point. They have plus 4 metal. They've got no metal extractors built right now. They're trying to restart, effectively. While their opponent has a good third of the map under their control. Yep, there we go. AutoWar is, in a very long way, saying GG. Oh, that I could not be sick. Seriously, if you're gonna throw in the towel, there's a resign button. But I see what they were saying. I was throwing in the towel in this one. But yeah, there's not much point. There is a light vehicle veteran built up. I could see maybe Scorch is gonna come out. Or levelers. If AutoWar knows they're doing the go for levelers, because they're going to need to get that splash damage. They're going to need to be able to build something to get rid of all these glaives. The gremlins are, of course, only useful for scouting at this point. And what they're going to scout out is going to be very useful. Willk sees it. Knows exactly what's going on. Sees that AutoWar is going. Oh, yeah, that's actually limited. They know about the light vehicle factory. AutoWar does not know about them. And the light vehicle factory has, what is it queued up? Oh yeah, warriors, good plan. That is a really good plan, because if levelers come up, warriors should take them out pretty quick. If scorches come up, warriors gonna take them out, no problem. And so far, it is nothing. Absolutely nothing. Okay, well, at any rate, AutoWar, are you surrendering or not? AutoWar is going for levelers. Okay, good plan. Gonna be like warriors are still a pretty useful unit in this particular situation. Levelers and warriors are gonna be fairly even. The warriors won't be able to protect the glaives, the levelers should be able to take out the glaives and some of the gremlins as well. Not all of them though. There are about a dozen gremlins on the map. This leveler will be able to take out the glaives, and the gremlins are nearby enough that'll be tricky. And the glaives coming down here trying to get rid of AutoWar's commander, and that leveler should stop them. Nope, the leveler's getting distracted. AutoWar's commander going down, and with that, AutoWar's entire economy. That's game if there ever was one. There is no way out of this. Hey, two levelers will not win against everything here, against all the stuff that Willk has. I mean, Willk has a very healthy economy. They have plus 28 metal. They got plus 58 energy thanks to this. They're overdriving like mad, too. Actually, not too much. But, well, no, times two. Yeah, that's pretty good. Or sorry, times 1.5. Like, Willk has the game in the bag. I'm not sure what. Okay, there we go. AutoWar's thrown in the towel. Took a little while, but Willk has taken it 2-1 against AutoWar. And no other changes have happened. There, Silent Shadow and Flaccid are playing. I don't know if Ophelius and Icons are playing as well. Let's see. Right now, in progress, we have Tournament Group D. Okay, that was done. We have turning group C, which is in progress. That is Orphelius and Icons. E is in progress. That is Silent Shadow and Flaccid. Both these games have been going for quite some time. I don't think there's much point in jumping onto them. And Old Ghost Doctor and Mr. Moon have not showed up, as far as I can tell. No. Oh yeah, Endless. I almost forgot about that guy, or that person. I haven't been playing in a while though. Endless has not been on. It's been a while since I've seen them. Okay, in all likelihood, I'm gonna end up casting either Clone and Baki Danta or Lowry and Kenku, or Lowry and Will K. I expect Lowry and Will K will be the next one. That seems the most likely thing. Lowry's already in this room, they're already ready to play. And Will K is also here, and the other games are kind of halfway through. Their series, I should say, are halfway through. And it looks like Lowry is... Yeah, we're still waiting on Mr. Moon and Old Ghost Doctor. I think maybe this entire section of the tournament just needs to be dropped completely. And ultimately, Orphelius and Icons would have been quarterfinals. Although, of course, there would have been some reseeding involved there, too. So, rather unfortunate we have a couple absentees and no subs. So I'll be getting... Oh, Clone back is a better game? Yeah, I suppose it would be, but... Is Baki Danta here? Oh yeah, Baki Danta is here. Well, I don't think Clone and Baki Danta are actually going to be... I don't think they're gonna take super long. Let's see. So Back to You Danta is... Where is Back to You Danta? Back to You Danta doesn't really do much right now. They're kind of waiting around. Probably watching the stream, seeing what's going on, seeing what's being played. But yeah, next, I think I am going to want to watch... I'm going to want to watch... And the Back to You Danta idea sounds pretty good. I just think that'd probably end up being... Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, Clone versus Back to You Danta. Let's get Game H out of the way, or Group H out of the way. That way, I can then just deal with that. I mean, it should be a pretty even game. Like, this match here, Lowry kind of has in the bag. I'm sorry, Will K. Will K knows this. Will K is already kind of joking. Yeah, I'm dead. So, it looks like it is going to be Back to You Danta and Clone. As soon as I see, where are they? No turning group H game has popped up yet. And it's just as they say that it pops up. All right, let's go. So Back to You Danta. I did want to see them because I haven't really seen them play much. I've seen them play a few times. Nothing that really sticks out to me though. Can't think of anything about their style. Actually, I'm not even sure I have cast game. I might very well have. I have a lot of games. I think I've casted a lot of matches. But I have this feeling that Back to You Danta is not one of them. Could be wrong. Might very well be. Let's see, Back to You Danta has never been cast by me. I have no idea what they do. Alright then, this will be a first, it'll be very interesting. Now, Clone, of course, I have cast many times. Very well-known player, very defensive player. Not a player that takes risks pretty much at all. And this being a second round map is going to start in Isis Delta. Very unusual, of course, but... Yeah, that's... That's Anarchist's choice. I honestly don't know what the thinking was behind using Isis Delta. It is one of the weirdest maps, one of the most asymmetric maps that you could really choose. Honestly, it's... yeah, not much to work from here. Well, let's see, we have... so Clone and Bactivnata are here. They are... Clone somehow in-game at the moment, probably just spectating something. And then, when they're ready, we shall begin! So, Clone, really the favorite to win this. Bactivnata is... I think good. Like I said, I've never really played him play. Let's see, what is Bactivnata's... what the heck is Bactivnata anyway? For that matter, I don't see them in the sign-up thread. Looking through the sign-up thread, I do not see their name unless they are otherwise named. No, Flipsip's not them. Nope, no idea. Actually, it would be Bactivnata because this is all tied together. So yeah, Bactivnata, I have no idea what their elo is. The Bactivnata is... 1v1 elo, 1466. Okay, I don't know why people were suggesting this would be a better game than Lowry versus Will K, but... whatever. Just whatever.